Good morning, students. Today we will start with our IIT Foundation chapter, that is gravitation, and we will start to see what is there in all the chapter in regarding to our gravitation syllabus. Okay. We have learned this chapter in our regular syllabus, in which we have already calculated what we have already learned what is the universal gravitation law. We have also learned about the calculating the value of small g. Then we have also learned about the Archimedes principle and all those, right? But in our IIT syllabus, we are going to focus mainly upon the universal gravitational force, and then relating to problems relating to that and relating to small g only. Okay, so this is mostly, this part is covered, taken from your 11th standard textbook. Okay, and what is there in that is just in summarized form to you now. Okay, so if you consider just in short what we have learned just going through the textbook, we have basically covered what is the introduction in our general. So what is the introductory part about gravitational force? That, you know, it is that force that is a universal force that bounds all the objects together. It is the reason why all the objects have coalesced to form, come together. Otherwise matter would be distributed form. Yes, why had matter come together? Because of this gravitational force. Okay, so going in details about what is that, it is the force that binds the moon towards the earth. That is why tides have been formed. Yes, tides have been formed. You experience the rotation of the earth around the sun and all these phenomena. Yes. Okay, now after the introductory part, let us see what is there in the our syllabus. Students, first we will learn what are Kepler's laws. Okay, Kepler's laws, it is given in short in your ninth textbook. These are three laws, those are given in your textbook. We will see in details now. Then we have acceleration due to gravity g. This acceleration due to gravity g you have found out for many planets in your regular syllabus. Yes. Yes, for many other planets, you have also found it for sun, other star also, you can find it out. The value, the formula is very simple. Small g equals to capital G into capital M upon R square. Yes, but now we are going to find the value of small g only related to one planet. Okay, only related to one planet, but we are going to vary it. Vary it means what? Value of small g when you are on ground. Value of small g when you are at certain height. Value of small g when you are under certain depth. Value of small g with related to certain latitudes, like, you know, latitudes. Yes, equator, Tropic of Capricorn, Tropic of Cancer, these latitudes. Okay, then as you go on poles. Okay, this variation of small g of the earth itself or at different conditions. Okay, this is what we are going to learn in gravitation lesson. Value of small g for different planets you have already found out. Then we just have concepts of mass, weight that we have learned in detail, but just we have in short. Orbital velocity, escape velocity, these are two new things that we learn, and we have a most important part, that is examples. Okay, this is the most important part. Okay, that we have given in you in some solved examples we have given you in our class in notebook form, notebook PDF. You have to solve those, as well as we will solve tomorrow. Okay, some of the problems. Today we'll complete our syllabus part. Okay, students, now we'll continue our next part, that is Kepler's laws. Okay, students, Kepler's laws were very defining moment in the whole understanding of our gravitation. They only proved the way for the actual understanding for the Newton's law. If Kepler's laws weren't there, there wouldn't be Newton's universal gravitational law as well. Okay, students, so Kepler's law are very important. Kepler was together with Tycho Brahe all his life entire, and for studied, observed and came out to these three laws which are then used. Okay, what are these three laws? See, the first law is called as law of orbits. What is it? All the planets move around the sun in an elliptical orbits with sun located at one of its foci. Okay, with sun at one of its foci. So let us draw an ellipse. Let us see how to draw an ellipse. Oscar. Okay, so we'll draw an ellipse in short. So first, in order to draw ellipse, you cannot draw it alone. You need one friend of yours. So I have one friend of mine, volunteer, please help me. Okay, so how to draw an ellipse? First, we will have two foci, okay, F1 and F2. Okay, so please, we have to keep two points fixed upon that, okay? Yes, now we have these two foci. You know how to draw a circle? One of the points is fixed and you rotate the other point. Likewise, you have to fix two foci and then you have to draw ellipse. So how to draw an ellipse? See, this is a very beautiful diagram of ellipse that you can draw. Okay, so is it like circle? Yes, thank you, sir, for drawing this elliptical part. So this is F1 and F2, where F1 and F2 are the two foci. Now, Sun, our Kepler's first law says that in order to, for the planetary motion to happen perfectly, what do you need is Sun should be located at one of its foci, and the planet revolves in such an orbit. Okay, this is the Kepler's first law. It is not circular, as we have learned, the planets rotate in circular motion. No, it is in elliptical motion. So this was observed by Kepler. It was such a great observation. And this is the first law. Okay, there will be a planet called Earth here. Okay, it might keep on rotating like this. As well as we have the Kepler's second law. Now, Kepler's second law is very important. What is that? What does that say? Kepler's second law states that the planets, the any planet sweeps out equal areas in equal interval of time. Okay, this is the Kepler's second law. What is the Kepler's second law? A planet sweeps out. Okay, what does it planet do? Planet, as it rotates around the elliptical path, it sweeps out equal areas. Equal areas in equal interval of time. Now, how does it sweep area? See, you have to join the Earth with Sun, and this is called as a radius vector. This is called as, students, radius vector. Now, this radius vector sweeps out equal areas. Means what? In certain time t1, if the area covered is a1, then in same time t1, in the next time t1, same time t1, it will also cover same area a1 only. In the next time t1 also, it will cover same area a1. That means what is constant is aerial velocity. What is constant is aerial velocity. The aerial velocity will be constant. Now see what happens. This length is a shorter length, while this length is the longer length. Yes, this length is the longer length. This length is called as the smaller length. If you just happen to study ellipse once again, so these are the two foci. Yes, if you draw an axis here and here, okay, so this becomes the minor axis because it is smaller, whereas this becomes the major axis. Okay, this becomes the major axis and this becomes the minor axis. Yes, okay. Yes, so what is understood is that the aerial velocity is remaining constant as you move out in certain time t. If area covered is a1, then in next time t1 also it should cover the same area a1. But what happens is, students, here the length has to increase. The length is increasing, but area should be same, because what they are saying, aerial velocity is constant. What is say, what they are saying is, in second law, in second law, what is they are saying is aerial velocity is constant. So to maintain the same area, as the Earth moves here, let us take, what happens, the length increases of the triangular part. So what happens is that the breadth is little less in order to keep the same area. So what does happen as it moves here? Its speed reduces, okay, in order to keep the same aerial velocity. So how does the planet move around the Sun? As it approaches here, it moves fast, and suddenly here it moves very, very slow, and as it comes close, it moves fast and then slows down, fast, slow down. This is what it performs. Why? In order to keep the aerial velocity constant. If they ask you how does this happen actually, then you have to say that it is because of angular momentum is conserved. L is called as angular momentum. It is conserved. You know, linear momentum is conserved. Any body that has got mass and velocity, it keeps on moving in straight line. It keeps on moving. Yes, but here what is it? It is not keeping moving in straight line. It is moving in rotational motion. So it has angular momentum, and that wants to remain constant. And because of such shape, it performs in order to balance the angular momentum, it keeps its aerial velocity constant. Now, what is angular momentum? You know, linear momentum is m into v. Just multiply by radius vector, r, you have angular momentum. This is in order to keep this constant, the aerial velocity is also constant. So, Newton's Kepler's second law of equal areas, also suggests that aerial velocity is constant as well as angular momentum is constant. So, they might ask you in MCQs. Okay, students, let us move on to the third law. What is the third law? Law of periods. What is law of periods? There are not one planet around the sun. There are many planets around the sun. Let us consider sun. Then we have not a single planet, right? So, we have many planets. So, let us see what happens when we compare many planets. Yes, we have many planets, right? Around the sun, situated at one of its foci, the earth moves in ellipse. Similarly, we have the Mars, let us take another planet, that is also moving in elliptical forms. So, what the Kepler's third law suggests is that if you know time of revolution of Earth, if you know time of revolution of Earth, as well as you know the radius vector r. What is the radius vector r? It is the semi-major axis. You know what is semi-major axis? Yes, just now you learned. These are the two situations, and if you join the center of the ellipse to any of the part of the longest part, so the major part, that is, and taking its half means what? Semi. This is major axis, this is semi-major axis. Okay, semi-major axis, it's called as r. Students, r is the semi-major axis, it's not like this. Okay, let us keep it over at this point E. Okay, and this is the half of its length. This is F1, this is F2, and this is the semi-major axis R. So, each and every planet has got elliptical orbit. Each and every planet has got its own semi-major axis. So, what the third law says is that for different planets, okay, if you know their time of revolution, that is time period T, and you also know their semi-major axis, then for each and every planet, it's the square of the time period is directly proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis. This is constant for all the planets. Means what? For example, you know T1, time period of Earth, that is 1 year, and you know semi-major axis of Earth, and you know, okay, so what we will write? 1 year squared is directly proportional to Earth's semi-major axis cube. You will write it like this. Similarly, if you want to know the time period of some other planet, like let us take Neptune, T of Neptune, and supposedly by a certain thing, you all have come to know the radius, semi-major axis of the Neptune. Then because this proportionality is same, what you can do is, you can directly find the time of revolution of another planet Neptune. How? By just putting T1, by taking ratios. Why? Because proportionality constant is same. So what we can do is, T1 upon Tn whole square equals to R1 upon Rn cube. You know time period of Earth, 1 year. You know semi-major axis of Earth with respect to Sun and of the other planets also. You need to know these basic things like lengths, so you can calculate the other things also, unknown things also. So this was found far before, and that is how he had deduced these three basic Kepler's laws, which helped you later on to understand how the universal gravitational law has been understood. Okay, students, so why this is important? Because it helps you to formulate. After studying these three laws, then Newton discovered the universal gravitational law. So, understood this? Okay, now we have learned the Kepler's laws. Write it down in your notebook properly. Now we will learn universal law. What is universal law, students? Newton's universal law of gravitation. Each and every particle in the universe attracts each and every other particle in the universe with a force that is proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the distance joining the centers between them. Yes, this is the Newton's universal law of gravitation, which can be mathematically put as F is directly proportional to m1 and m2 and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. This is one body called m1 in universe and another body, any other body in the universe. Okay, this is any two bodies in the universe. Okay, they will experience a force. They will experience a force towards each other. This force is of attractive force. Okay, this force is of attractive force, and this force is proportional to what? Product of these two masses, but it is inversely proportional. Means it becomes less when it is inversely proportional to the distance joining the centers between them. Now, how to draw the distance between the centers between them? Just you have to draw the shortest distance joining the centers between them. It is inversely proportional. Now, proportionality we understood. But what is the value of this proportionality? Its value of proportionality, we know that it is as mass increases, multiply its mass, oh, the force will increase. What about the next? Radius will increase, it will decrease. But decrease how? If radius increases two times, distance increases two times, force decreases four times. This proportionality only we understood. But what is the value of that a constant g that has to be put? So that only you will get the actual value of force. You know proportionality. Proportionality means what? If one thing increases, in what ratio the other thing increases, that only we understood. But what should be the actual value it will, with which it would increase? That was understood by putting the value of the constant. And that constant was called as universal gravitational constants. Now after putting this, we could actually find out the actual value of force. Now this value of G was found out by Henry Cavendish. He performed experiment. Now how to find constants? Do the experiment, know the force. Okay, so he used a torsional balance experiment that is there in 11th standard students. What did he do? He kept two gold balls, also two very high metallic balls. He experimented it and found, he measured the value of these masses. He actually measured the value of this R with a very sensitive balance. This, if he has to find the value of G, he has to keep it very sensitive. And he then also calculated the value of force by his restoring force, that is understood by his general mechanics. Now then he put all these values and then he put the value of G, and then he found the value of G, which was actually what? 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11. Students, minus 11 means what? 0.000, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then you have this 6, 6, 7. Such a small number, when multiplied to the mass, you imagine such a small force is there. That is why any two objects kept in front of you should experience such a small force. Okay. So, but how does the Earth keep the moon with it? Because the masses actually itself are so high that even if this small number is multiplied, still the force exists. So this is the value of G. Now with the value of G, you also need to know what? The unit. Now how to find the unit? Just rearrange to form the G. Now what is this here? G, if we want, then G is there here. So G's unit is what? If you consider G, just consider this case. And so what do we have is G equals, this is Newton. This is distance squared, here becomes meter squared, and mass into mass kg. Kg is becoming here denominator. So the unit of G would be what? Unit of G would be 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg squared. Okay, this was how the Cavendish successfully found the value of G. Okay, students. Now we will move to the next point. What is that? The null point. Okay, now many students asked me during the lockdown, what is null point, sir, with how to find it out. So what is null point? See, that when on Earth, you will fall on Earth. Yes. When on Moon, you will fall on Moon. But what about any point between Earth and Moon where you will neither fall there nor here? So that point where you will experience equal force from Earth and Moon and you will not fall anywhere, that point is null point. So how to find out that? Just what is that concept, that you will not fall anywhere because what? Because you will experience force from Earth equal to the force on Moon. So you have to just equate those point and find the value of that null point. Now let us see how to find that value of null point. Okay, let us take two bodies, M1 and M2, and keep a test mass. What is the test mass? Test mass means what? It is just used for testing. Like there is Earth, let us call it M1, and there is Moon, let us call it M2. There is a distance called as D between the two centers, okay? And then we have any point X. Let us assume that we found out, because we don't know. So how to find? You know maths. You don't know anything? Just put it value of X. X means what? You don't know that. So just put it X. At X, we have that null point N. Yes? Now, if this is X, this is D, then what should be this? Yes? D minus X. Okay. Now, this is that null point where you will neither fall on Moon, nor fall on, neither fall on Earth, nor fall on Moon. So, what do? We keep it a test mass, whose mass, let us take 1 kg. Whatever is mass, let us put it at 1 kg, okay? Let us call it small m. Now, what this body will experience? This body will experience force of gravitation due to this body. Now, don't consider this Moon. So, this body will be attracted to this Earth by which force? Gravitational force. What is the formula? Go to the universal law. Force is directly proportional to, means now we will use constant, product of masses, M1, test mass M upon the distance square, that is X square, right? Because we are talking about these two bodies, which is equal to this force. Why equal? Because we are already talking about null point. This force is proportional to the product of two masses. Proportional, we have used the proportionality. Product of two masses, M2, again test mass M, upon what? Distance square, D minus X square. Now what can get cancelled? Proportionality, force of gravitation is same. So proportionality is also same for both the bodies. Test mass, that is also same for both the situations. So what do you have here? M1 upon X square equals M2 upon D minus X square. So this is that standard equation where you can put the mass of Earth, mass of Moon, mass of Moon. You know the distance between Earth and Moon? Yes. Yes, students, you know the mass of Earth, mass of the Moon, distance between Earth and Moon. You can find the value of X, solve this quadratic equation. You can find the value of X where the null point is obtained, that is the point where both the force of gravity due to Earth and Moon are equal and opposite, so that it might not fall anywhere. That is the null point. Okay, students, so this is that equation. So null point is over. Now, relation between small g and capital G in terms of rho. Students, what is rho? Rho is, yes, you know that, density. Okay, so let us find the value of small g and capital G in terms of density. You have already known what is the value of small g. What is small g? Comparing. What is that? Comparing our general force equation. Second law. What is force? F is equals to ma. Second law. NLM2. You know that. What is the, by universal gravitational law? Universal gravitational law. F is equals to what? GMM upon R square. Can we equate these two? Yes. So when we equate, because the body that is going to be on the Earth will experience force due to Newton's second law and due to gravitational also. Let us equate them. GMM upon R square equals MA. Now when it falls, you don't use the word A. You know what do you use? When it falls, you use the word G. So let us call this as G. Now what cancels? So what is G? GM by R square. Now what is R? R is actually the distance between the two bodies, because we are talking about UGL, universal gravitational law, where R is what? The distance between the two centers. So it, on the surface of the Earth, it has to be actually equal to the radius of the Earth itself. Might be 2 meters more, 3 meters more. Just ignore that. In front of 6,400 kilometers, 2 meters, 3 meters would not change the value, right? Just put it. Okay. Now, what do we know? Mass. We want to know in terms of rho. So, what is mass? Mass is density into volume upon R square equals to G. Now, what is volume of a Earth is which shape? Sphere. Right? Sphere. What is the volume of sphere? Volume of sphere is given by 4 by 3 pi r cube. So, V equals 4 upon 3 pi r cube. Just substitute here g into rho into 4 by 3 pi r cube upon r square equals g. Yes. Now what can get cancelled, students? This is r cube and this is r square. So what is this? When it is going up, it will become minus. So let us solve it here. Okay. So what is the value of G? What is the value of G? Capital G, rho 4 by 3 pi r 3 minus 2. So finally what we can write is, final equation, we can use it to box G equals capital G rho 4 by 3 pi 3 minus 2 is 1. So now we can just equate it. Okay, this is the value of relationship between small g and capital G in terms of rho. Okay, so this is the third and final equation. Okay students, now we will move on to the next part. What we have learnt is, now just before now we learned the value of small g, now we will learn the value of small g with the height, depth, latitude, poles and rotation. Okay, now value of small g you calculated in terms of rho, right? You can also find the value of small g for moon and all the other planets. You have known this basic formula, okay, on for any planet. Just use its mass, use its radius and find out its value. But for a given planet, for a given planet, what is the value of g? If you put it here, you go inside the earth, you go outside the earth, you go on this latitudinal point, you go on poles. Because earth is also rotating, so if its effect is counted or what, if earth is also rotating, so all these parameters we'll study. See, with height, okay, value of small g as you move, because this is useful, important. Why? Because you know what is weight. Weight is equals to mg, right? The value of g decides your weight. Your weight on the earth's surface will be equals to mg, but as you move on higher and higher, you move on Mount Everest, you are weighing 60 newtons on earth's surface. Will you weigh 60 newton on Mount Everest? No, you will weigh a little lesser. How to find out that, all we'll see. If you go inside a well, keep on digging out the earth to certain considerable extent, will you weigh 60 newtons only? No, you will weigh again lesser only. That we'll see how. If you go on poles, what happens on poles? That is a different phenomenon. You will weigh more. That also we'll see. And finally, due to earth's rotation, that is also one effect. That is also we'll see. Okay, that is all related to this main formula. So just see how to, what we do with this main formula that helps us to find the value of g. First we'll see with respect to a height, with respect to height. So what happens as we move higher and higher above this earth's surface? You know what we move, what happens with, as we move higher and higher above the earth's surface is that earth has got certain radius. As you keep a body, okay, on a certain height h, on a certain height h, now what happens is that, this is the earth's surface, okay, what happens is that, because gravitational law says that it is inversely proportional to the distance, as the distance increases, the force has to decrease, right? So acceleration also then decreases, because mass of the body is remaining same, so the acceleration of due to gravity of this body is decreasing. Now how does it decrease? Just put the value of small g. What is that small value of small g? If for this body, if it would have been placed on the earth, it would be g m upon r square. Now what you are going to do with that? You are going to raise this body at certain height, so the distance has been increased. You know what is that? Actually it is nothing but the force. So only force. But just let us consider this mass negligible, because that only mass we are going to study, right? So let us only calculate its acceleration part. Okay, force is nothing, going to be same. It is going to be different only because of acceleration is different, because that mass only we are going to study, right? Now with certain height, what happens? G m, with increase in height, what will be the total height? R plus h together whole squared will be the new height. So if you know the value of h, that is to be asked, right? They will give you a question at certain height h. And can you find the new value of g dash? Yes, but this can be even simplified. Actually this complication, this calculation might go a little complicated, right? So what we can do is just compare these two, because you know this value, right? This would get again cancelled. Just compare it. Okay, so what do we do? What do we do? It just take the ratios. Okay, just take the ratio. Okay, equation 1, equation 2. Okay, divide equation 1, divide equation 2 by 1. So what do we have? G dash upon G equals what? Gm upon r plus h whole squared upon gm upon r square. Just further simplify, gm should get cancelled with gm. Denominator goes to numerator, and denominator of numerator comes as it is down. So r plus h whole square. So this is that equation. This is that equation. Okay, so rewrite it and just see g dash is equals to g into r upon r plus h the whole square. This is the variation of g with respect to height, but only when the height is very very high. Only when the height is very high. But what for normal distances like 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers? What happens is that because this value is very high, this will amount to some certain considerable value here. But this value is very very low. Then approximately you think it should be same, right? But you need to find out the values. So what we do? We have to solve it. We will solve its complexity. Okay, just take this equation and expand it mathematically. So what we will do is we'll expand it mathematically. See how to do it. Let us solve the value of g dash. Again, g, let us take it 1 upon numerator becomes what? Denominators, denominator. So what we can do is r plus h upon r. Again whole squared. Now what we can do is simplify further. This can be equals to g upon 1 upon r upon r. R is 1 plus h by r whole square. Yes. Now what can we do is we can take this upwards. So what does it become? What does it become? G dash equals g 1 plus h by r whole raised to minus 2. Yes. Now we have binomial theorem. Okay. What is that? A 1 plus x raised to n. We have this binomial theorem. What does it say? 1 plus x raised to n gives you 1 plus x raised to n gives you. You have this binomial theorem. You might write it down. 1 plus nx into plus n into n minus 1 upon 2 factorial into x squared, and it goes on going. This is not for you. Just write it down. This is for higher in 11th standard. So this is the binomial expression which just simplifies. Now if we want to solve this value, let us put this as h. So what is the value of x here? Value of x is h by r, and value of n is minus 2. So what happens is that if we solve it, g and 1 is 1, so just solve it, this 1 n into x. What is the value of n? Minus 2. Minus 2 into x is what? H by r plus. Now you might solve this entire thing. You might, let us take, you have solved this. Minus 2 minus 1 is minus 3 upon 2 factorial. 2 factorial means 2 multiplied by 1 up till 1 comes. Plus x squared means what? H by r whole square. Plus you have this value. Again, what will be the next term here? N, third term will be, if you want to know, n into n minus 2. It goes on going, keeps on going. N into n minus 1 upon 3 factorial. It keeps on going. It's a different long process. N minus 1 into n minus 2 becomes 3 factorial. Then its powers increases. Likewise, it keeps on going. But that is not part. Why? Because students, this value of h is very very small, because it would be only 2 kilometers, and this value of r will be 6400 kilometers. So what happens is that the value of h by r, 2 upon any bigger value, it will be such a small number that after squaring it, it becomes even smaller. What will the square of 0.1? It is 0.01. What is the square of 0.01? It is 0.0001. Right, so it will be 2 upon 6400 kilometers is such a small number. After squaring, it is going to be even smaller. So such smaller numbers are not considered. Okay, you will only consider, because they are neglected. So only term considerable is this term, because entirely that is considered as equals to 0. So what our answer becomes? G dash is equals to g into 1 minus 2h by r. So this is the value of gravity for a only high, okay, little high value of gravity for bodies which are placed little high above the earth's surface for very high. So understood the value of height? Value of g at certain height, it is equals to this formula for bodies kept at considerable height for or very high, and for bodies considered low heights or little high, you have to use this formula. When 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers such values are given, if you need to find the value of small g, use this formula. Otherwise, use this formula. Its derivation will be never asked to you. Just remember these two values. Binomial theorem is there for you later on in 11th standard. Just remember those. Calculation part, if somebody asks, just remember, because this value is become very, very low. If in case it comes for home EVA exam. Okay, so write these two points. Now we'll go for depth. Okay. Now with depth, what happens? As you keep on digging down into the earth, what happens? As you keep on digging down into the earth, so what happens is that if you have earth, okay, and as you keep down digging into the earth, into a tunnel, let us take you have dug up till this point and you are standing here and you need to find your own weight. So what you do is, you need to find the value of weight is equals to what? Mg, right? So, but what is the value of g? G will be the acceleration due to gravity, what the gravitational force will experience. But students, see here, with we are talking about acceleration due to gravity at j. What will be this value of g? Will it be same? It will be different, because what happens? The force of gravitation experienced by this man will be only by that part which is joining the center of this person to the center of earth. So what is the distance? Only this much. So what part of body that is that would attract this person by gravitational law? Only this part of the sphere. Okay, so the earth for the person will not be the entire earth, it will be this part of the earth only, because this part of the earth is not going to pull him down. Okay, this is become a different body for him, so this part is not to be considered. Okay, so for what we have to find the gravitational acceleration by this part of the body only. So we'll again use the same formula, small g equals g m upon r square, but now g dash equals what? G dash equals g m dash, mass is changed, upon r dash square. Now what is m dash? M dash is this mass. Now what is this mass? Mass of this body entirely. See, its volume is different. Earth is to be considered with uniform density. Earth has to be considered with uniform density. So if density is same for a different volume, will you have different mass? Yes. We know mass is equals to density into volume. So the new mass m dash will be equals to density of the earth is same into v dash. Now what is v dash? The new volume. That is 4 by 3 pi r dash cube. Is it not? Now what is r dash? They will give you in question that the person has gone d meters deep. And what else do you know? You know the radius of the earth, that is r. Value of r is always 6400 kilometers. Converted into meters, not required now. Let us put it in terms of r only. Okay, so what is r dash? So r dash equals what? R minus d, because we are talking about only this distance. So what is this distance? This distance will be r minus d, students. Okay, so r dash equals to r minus d, the new radius of the new earth. New earth, let us call it. So what is that? Finally, that is equals to m dash equals what? Rho 4 by 3 pi r minus d whole cube. This is the new mass of the earth, which will be coming here. So let us solve it. G into what is the new mass? Rho into volume 4 by 3 pi, which is r minus d whole cube, upon r dash. What is r dash? R minus d whole squared. Now this is 3 and this is 2. So 3 minus 2 is directly 1. So G rho 4 by 3 pi r minus d. Is it? Yes, this is it. And this is what? Actually, this is g dash. Okay. Now, what is g on the surface of the earth? You had calculated just few minutes before. It was what? Value of g. जी वॉज फोर जी रो 4/3 पाई आर. दिस वॉज इट वेन इट वॉज ऑन द सर्फेस ऑफ द अर्थ. जस्ट गो बिफोर दिस वॉज रिटन, जस्ट गो ऑन टू द वीडियो दिस बिफोर दिस वॉज रिटन. वी आर कैलकुलेट वैल्यू ऑफ स्मॉल जी इन टर्म्स ऑफ कैपिटल जी with respect to rho when this was given. So while now we can use for comparing. Why? Because this is not with respect to mass. When mass is different, density is constant, no? So we'll use with respect to densities. 1 and 2. Let us compare 1 and 2 now. G dash upon G equals this upon this. So what is that? All the terms are same, right? G rho 4/3 pi. G rho 4/3 pi. So directly write R minus D upon R. R minus D upon R. Further simplify it. G dash equals G R by R 1 D by R. So this is that final equation with respect to depth. These derivations are not asked nowhere for you. Just remember this values. But in case if it asks some cross questioning in Homi Baba, you might know it. Okay, so remember this variation of depth. Okay, so this is what we found out. Okay, now let us see what happens with height and with depth all together, both of them together. Okay, now see what happens. Have you written this down? Pause it and write it down. Okay, now let us compare both of these. Now you know if this is the earth, on the surface of the earth its value of g is 9.8. Let us write g like this, not to be confused with 9. Okay, g is equals to 9.8. as you go on deep, depth increases, this term is going to again bring this down, right? So g value of g is, it's minus na, so as depth increases this will become lesser value. So g dash, it will be 9.8, will it be lesser than 9.8, it will be 7 something. And as you move higher, what was the formula? G equals to what? G dash is equals to g into R by R plus H whole square, as well as the lesser height formula was what? G into 1 minus 2H by R. These two were the formulas. So what happens? Even when height is increased, this term will become less. Even when height is increased more, denominator is bigger, again the value is less. So G will be maximum at earth surface only. At depth, it's lower. At height, then also it's lower. Can we put this both on a graph? Let us see how to put it on a graph. Okay, if you put d equals to r, what happens? D equals to r, r upon r 1, 1 minus 1 0, so gravitational acceleration will be 0 at the center of the earth. Okay, at the earth center your weight will be 0. So value of g at the earth center is 0. Value of g at the earth surface is equals to how much? 9.8. so if we plot 9.8 here, it is becoming 9.8 here. So that is constant, right? The graph is constant. It will, as the distance increases, g decreases. So we can put it on a straight line graph. What is a straight line graph? Uniform straight line. As the distance increases, gravitational increases as you move from the center of the earth. As distance d increases, d is 0, 1, g increases. If you put d equals to 2, again g will increase. Is this straight line? You know how you have studied graph? Yes. As one quantity, x quantity increases, y also increases. As d increases, g also increases. After surface of the earth, you will not use this formula. You will use these two formulas. For lower heights, what happens? You will use this formula. Okay. What is this formula? Minus 2h by r for depth. Okay. For a lower heights. For lesser heights, we'll take. Okay, so what happens is this formula is, what is that? Minus 2h by r. So means what? Minus 2h means what? It increases, decreases two times. Means height is increased by 1 meter. One quantity, g dash reduces. Minus 2 means what? Reduces more. Okay, so at one meter depth, if you go. Okay, if you, this is r, this is equals to surface of the earth. Let us write. At this point, r equals to 6400 kilometers. If you move 1 kilometer down, at this point, what will be the value of gravity? It will be lesser. On graph, if you see, then it will be at, let us say, 8.8 value of g. But if you go on to the value of 1 kilometer higher, then what should happen? It is, if you just multiply here by 1, put the value of 1 here, then what happens? This value is decreased more, because here there is no 2 factor, only 2 factor is there here, so its value is still lesser. So what happens is that at 1 kilometers it will not give 8.8, it will give little lesser, it will give 7.8. So what happens is that at 1 kilometer its value is still lesser. Okay, so what happens is that it suddenly, the graph is little curve, it is little more steep, slope is more steep. Okay, and finally what happens when the height is increased to a more value, then it decreases with square proportionality. Square proportionality means what? In if you just plot the value of y equals to x square, value of y and x, if you put 1 square is 1, 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, so graph becomes like this, right? It doesn't increase. So with inverse square, it becomes, this slope becomes inverse, so the graph becomes like this. So at infinite height, what happens? When height is very, very far, g will become 0. When at infinity, far infinity in space, if you go on very, very high, at that point the value of g will become very, very less. Okay students, just in case this lecture, today's lecture, is going little too much, do not worry, because it is just remember what it is, little higher for you, because all of a sudden this has come. Just remember these values and remember what you understand. You can ask, keep on asking questions. Okay, this is the graphical. If it comes in exam, don't worry about anything. 1, 2, 3, only remember these 3 things, that's it. Don't remember anything else, it's okay, but just you need to keep on going through this. Okay, with latitude, what happens with latitude? With latitude means, you know what is latitude? Latitude, tropic of Cancer, Capricorn. As you go on higher and higher, what happens is that as you go on higher and higher, Earth's shape is little bulged, right? Earth's shape is little bulged, it's like this, you know, because of rotation. Yes, so what happens, the distance, actual distance of this is very, very lesser, this distance is more. Because this distance is more, gravitational force for a body which is here, it is lesser. This value, if it is 9.8, yes, whatever is the value of g, it's 9.8, then if that body moves here, then what happens, value of g is what? Gm upon r square. But what is the value of g dash on the poles? Let us write g for poles. It will be what? Gm upon r at the poles squared. Now what happens? The value of r pole is very, very less. If denominator is less, value is more. So at poles, value of gravity is more. Okay. So at poles, value of gravity is more. But mass is same. So if mass is same, mg will be different here and mgp will be higher here, mgp will be lower here. So your weight will be more at the poles, more at the poles. One more last point is remaining, that is due to rotation.